Joining us is George 2.0. George, thanks so much for being here with us.
Thanks for having us.
Of course. George, you were there when Scott delivered that moving speech. What was it like to be there?
I mean, the energy in the room was unbelievable. I'd actually seen him walking in. We were both checking in through security at the same time. And I remember it like it was yesterday. It was July 16th, my birthday, and I only wanted to put up a picture of me and Stuart Scott. And I walked up to him, and the way that he was laboring to get into the building, it made me decide that I didn't want to get in his way. I knew he had something really important to do, even though I didn't know what he was going to be doing. And so later that night, when I saw him, after having seen him off stage, just going through what he was going through to actually get his body to the arena, seeing him with the same fervor and the same power and the same excitement that we're used to seeing Stuart Scott have, get on stage and win the battle in front of us, as he said, in the way in which he lived, in the way in which he presented himself, not showing defeat, not accepting, you know, that cancer was taking over his body at the time, but still sounding the same. We had always known Stuart Scott's sound. It was inspiring, and you could feel that feeling in the entire room.
Yeah, he certainly was an inspiration. Now, Stuart Scott joined ESPN2 in 1993. Now, for millennials, that's nearly like their entire life. Yeah. But help us understand, what was it like before Stuart Scott changed how sports was told on TV?
Well, you're right, Melissa. For millennials, that is almost everything we can remember about sports journalism. So prior to him showing up in 93, you had, you know, the cookie cutter, white, comb over, blue, double-breasted suit wearing journalist. And here comes Stuart Scott wearing the Ron Johnson with the mustache, the highlighter yellow shirt, and just giving us booyahs and all of this energy. He was actually inspiring to a lot of us who understood at that time that he was giving hip-hop, you know, a spot at the table that it hadn't had before. You got to think about it. There was a legitimacy to the way that he infused popular culture. We forget about it now because sports journalism and mass media uses so much of what is popular in social culture today, but they weren't doing that before. They weren't quoting OPP when the defensive player had a steal. They weren't saying booyah when there was a home run slugger that was hitting the ball out of the park. These things weren't happening. And so he gave a voice and a legitimacy to a culture that we didn't understand people really would appreciate in the way that they did. At first, we thought it might have been a little corny. We thought it might have been a little off-putting. We were afraid
yeah,
about how people
would
respond to it, but they loved it.
Yeah, because he had style. He had his own style and that unique, dynamic,
yeah,
extraordinary energy. I want to share with you a couple of vines. These are tributes to people that people use Stuart's catchphrases as cool as the other side of the pillow. Is it a healing process for people to go to social media to share their memories of Scott, do you think, George?
Well, absolutely. I mean, this is the way that he inspired us to be ourselves, not only by watching him, but using our own, you know, properties as our own form of journalism. So I think that when people share these kinds of stories, it helps to recant the story and bring his memory back. A lot of us, you know, thought we were having these experiences by ourselves watching Stuart Scott. We weren't sharing the way that we share nowadays. I can remember playing NBA Jam and hearing his voice, boom, shakalaka. You know, you didn't hear those, you weren't sharing those.
Nobody else was saying that. That was all Stuart Scott. He was an incredible journalist, and he will certainly be missed. George, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. And my best to his daughters as well. Please don't forget them in this story.
Absolutely. Sydney and Taylor. We won't forget them either.